And epistasis is when you're dependent on one gene for an expression of another gene, for example, blood groups. And then the dependent gene or the gene that you need is fructose transferase. And if you don't have fructose transferase, you're automatically O-type blood. So if you have the genes for A blood but you lack fructose transferase, you're going to be O blood. Okay, and just know these things. N-acetylgalactosamine is for A, D-galactose is for D. And just know that sickle cell, thalassemia, and glucose 6-phosphate deoxyribonucleic deficiency are examples of heterozygous advantage. And then the question that you're going to get is about this person is like B-type blood, what type of blood can you give them? Okay, so you have acute hemolytic reactions and delayed hemolytic reactions. So acute hemolytic reactions, they happen immediately, and it only involves mismatches involving the A, B, and O blood types. Okay, then for delayed, you get the reaction after a week, and this is for any mismatch that's, you know, the weird blood groups he talks about, yeah, so that those are delayed hemolytic reactions. So ABO, and for delayed the weird blood groups he talks about in the end. Okay, and this one, febrile non-hemolytic reaction, this one, it's not involving blood, it's involving like your HLAs, MHCs, so your immune cells and organ transplants. Your white blood cells and organ transplants. And then for hemolytic disease of the newborn, it only occurs when the mother is Rh negative and the fetus is Rh positive. And to treat them, you give them Rogam. The function of Rogam is to prevent the formation of anti-Rh antibodies. Okay, any questions so far in this lecture? Because I think that's it. Okay, so leukopenia, decreased white blood cells, leukocytosis, increased white blood cells, and agranulocytosis is very low white blood cells. Just know this picture of the tongue. The purulent tongue is an example of agranulocytosis. And just know this is more severe. Okay, just know that exercise increases the levels of circulating white blood cells. Okay. And then glucocorticoids. Just know glucocorticoids do that as well. Yeah. Okay. Shift to the left is a sign of an infection. And the more the bigger the shift, the more severe the infection. And the way to tell that it's a bigger shift is if you see that the cells are more immature. Okay, and then for these ones, toxic granules, bony bodies, and vacuoles, these are a sign of sepsis. These things are signs of sepsis. Okay. So a leukomorphic reaction, just know that this is a very high white blood cell count. And you have to differentiate this between leukemia, and to do that you do a lab score. And a lab score just shows how mature are white blood cells, so if they're immature, you could think of it as cancer. Any question? Huh? If it's immature, it's cancer. So we'll lab score immature leukemia. And for these ones, the increase of the specific blood cell, if you know what the white blood cell counteracts, then you should know why they're increased. So eosinophilia, parasite infection, allergies. Basophilia, just know that it's either in cancer or a severe allergy. Okay, so for macrophages, still dead markers for chronic inflammation. So neutrophils, acute inflammation, macrophages, chronic inflammation. Okay, and then mono, what do you know about this? Okay. So I've talked about a football player, that's mono. And just know the two, actually don't worry about the viruses. I think you just know about the hepatosplenomegaly, and they can't play contact sports because of the splenic rupture. So for mono, you have to know about Downy cells, and Downy cells are CD8 T cells that attack your B lymphocytes that have been infected with the EBV virus. Okay, so now that you know that the T cells are attacking the B cells, you should know that the paracortex has an increased growth in the lymphocytes for mono. Okay? And just know that the virus invades CD21, and CD21 is complement receptor 2. Okay, any questions about this? Okay, and then the mono spot test is how you test for mono. Okay? If it's IgM, it's an acute reaction. If it's IgG, it's a chronic reaction. And I think that's it. No. Okay, and then for the lymph nodes, just know what they look like in like a histological section and know the causes. So follicular hyperplasia, remember the follicles have the B cells, so it's a B cell, something involving B cells. Interfollicular or paracortex hyperplasia involves T cells, and sinus drainage, something about cancer. Okay. So follicular hyperplasia, HIV early stage, why is it the HIV early stage? Because HIV attacks your T cells, so if you have no T cells, you have your B cells compensating. Okay, so early HIV, increased B cells, follicular hyperplasia. Then paracortical hyperplasia, T cells, sinus hyperplasia, lymph node drain, a cancer. Okay, any questions about this lecture? I'm looking for the part of this, so if you find it, let me know. So my slides are a bit different, but this entire lecture, it's an intro lecture, so I'll just focus on the definitions. So, pharmacokinetics, what your body does to the drug, and pharmacodynamics, what the drug does to the body. So just know the definitions. They'll give you a vignette, and then I'll ask you, in this vignette, which of these is an example of a pharmacokinetic, something like that. Okay, can I skip all this? This was a straightforward lecture, right? And I just focus, it's just the definitions. Okay, and then to the actual farm, I'll go to the actual farm. Oh, they like the inverse agonists. And just know that this acts on receptors that are always active, so, okay. You don't have inverse agonists? Okay, don't worry about them. Okay. So, the histamines. You just have to know what the H1 and H2, where they're found, and then what signaling they're involved. You have this, right? Okay. But do you have the thing? No? Okay. Okay, so just know that the difference between second and first generation is that first generation crosses the blood-brain barrier. Okay, and just know that diphenhydramine is only first generation, so there you go. What was I about to say? Oh, yeah. Yeah, make sure you know that. The H. Yeah, you have to know the cells. Well, if you have this information, you have to know the receptor subtype and the type of cell signaling. So whether or not it's GQ or GS. And if it talks about the location, you might have to know that as well. And diphenhydramine is the only topical drug. So if you have someone going to the forest or camping and he gets a rash, you give him diphenhydramine to treat for the night. Okay, any questions about this lecture? Okay. This root of the neck, is this going to be your mini? Dr. Elliott gave you this lecture, right? So she covers what you need to know. So, okay. I don't really know what to talk about in this lecture. Hold on, let me try to remember. Oh, something about the blood supply for the thyroid. Okay, I think you already have that. Okay.
Yeah, I don't really know what's going on this lecture.
I think I'm just going to skip it. Hold on, I'm just going to look for more stuff. They're usually like temporal components. It's more like the circuit, like if you do some surgery or something, what's damaged. But yeah, I don't really know what to talk about this. So like, for example, if you remove someone's thyroid, when it's going to be damaged, that's the recurrent there of the ulnar. Okay, so I'm going to skip anatomy for now. Because honestly, I can't really teach you anatomy. Okay, if you see anti-anemia drug, I'll recommend it. Who gave you this lecture? Dr. Chambers? Let's see. Honestly, just note the drug class. Don't worry too much about the contraindications or the adverse effects. Like, if there's anything important to know about, like, an adverse effect, she pulls it out. Actually, she didn't pull out anything. Okay, let me just start. Okay. So whenever you give someone EPO therapy, so erythropoietin, you have to give them all the preps, okay? So you give them iron, B12, and folic acid. You have folic acid and leucovorin, right? Okay, so just know that leucovorin, it does not need DHFR. Yeah, it's really low. Oh. Ferrous gluconate. Deferoxamine is when someone like eats meals and they get iron poisoning, you give them deferoxamine because it's IV, and IV 100% bioavailability and fast onset of action. And deferasirox is oral, so you know someone who has hemochromatosis, you give them deferasirox. There's something important about ferrous glucomate. I forgot what it was. Ferrous glucomate is the one you give during EPO therapy. Okay, then darbepoietin alpha is glycosylated, therefore it has a longer half-life. Epoietin alpha is endogenous erythropoietin. Darbepoietin alpha is glycosylated, so it has a longer half-life. Epoietin alpha is endogenous erythropoietin. But Dr. Chambers, she pretty much uses her practice questions for the exam. So any detail that you need to know, it's in her practice questions. Okay, any questions about this lecture? Don't try to memorize all the adverse effects or contraindications. Like, good rule of thumb for farm, they hold to anything you need to know. Is improvement in practice, is that testable?
Yeah.
The improvement in practice? Yeah. Let me know if you found it. The types of systems, so if it's self-care, patient treats himself. microbe system. It's this one individual caregiver and the patient, that's the doctor-patient interaction. Microbe system is like the doctor's office. Mesosystem is like the cardiac unit in the hospital. And the macro system is like the community. It's the macro system is like the entire hospital. Meso is like a unit, like this unit's dedicated to one person. Someone say something? Quality gap. It's gonna be a quality gap. So I think it was like the question was you get the results back from the exam and you notice you're below 30 on average. What is this? And it's a quality gap. Okay. And the fishbone. Where's the fishbone diagram? Just know that you use the fishbone diagram to identify a quality gap. Okay. Oh, that was it? Short day. So boundaries, no boundaries, the parotid fossa, the parotid gland, let's see, what was it? Did I already go through this? I did. Okay. Just know that the facial nerve passes through the parotid gland. And then the parotid sheath versus the parotid gland. Okay, so make sure you know the innervation of the parotid sheath, whether or not superior and lower. So superior auriculotemporal, lower great auricular. Okay, and then innervation of the parotid. So all the glands in your face are innervated by cranial nerve 7, except for parotid, which is innervated by cranial nerve 9. And just know that sensory for the parotid gland is auriculotemporal. Okay. Okay, you have another boundary, temporal fossa. Okay, they're obsessed with the pterygoids. So medial is elevation, lateral is depression. The lateral ligaments prevents posterior dislocation. Just know that this nerve carries taste innervation. Whatever. I'm looking for something. Okay. So sialolithiasis salivary stones. Don't worry about that too much. Sjogren's syndrome, if the question says that she has dry eyes and dry mouth, Sjogren's syndrome, because this is an autoimmune disease to the glands of your face. Parotiditis is an inflammation of the parotid gland. And then something that's important to know is that an obstruction at the parotid duct causes parotiditis. Yeah, the same. Okay, and this one, auriculotemporal syndrome. So the surgeon popped up. So every time the parasympathetic and sympathetic fibers innervating the parotid gland are combined. So whenever the person eats, they start getting sympathetic innervation, so they start sweating. And this is just caused by a surgical error. Then dislocation of the jaw damages the facial and auriculotemporal nerve. Okay, then the inferior alveolar nerve block blocks your lower jaw, your lower lip, lower jaw, and then, yeah. Any questions about this? Yeah.